advisor at Singularity University. So please, I want to hear a roar in this stage. Welcoming José Luis Cordero!
I want to talk about immortality. Actually, I am currently writing a book called The Death of Death. So I want to welcome you to the new world of immortality. This is a fantastic time that we are living. We are between the last human mortal generation and the first immortal generation. And you can decide where you want to be. If you want to be part of those who will die or part of those that will live indefinitely. Immortality has been the dream of humanity. The first book ever written, which is the Epic of Gilgamesh, was about immortality. All big civilizations have been talking about immortality forever. The pharaohs of Egypt, the Emperor Qin of China, who unified China for the first time. He's the one who built the terracotta warriors. He also believed in immortality. However, they did not have the technology in those days. Today we do technology for many things, and actually I had a personal experience with death. I was basically, I had a brain malaria. It's the worst type of malaria that you can have. It's caused by a parasite called Plasmodium falciparum. And I was 3 days in coma. Fortunately, I did not die because my brain is very small, and the parasite did not go to my brain, even though it was brain malaria. Otherwise, I could have been dead, as you might imagine. So I am lucky enough not to have died of cerebral malaria. But having been so close to death and having been 3 days in coma, you know, I appreciate life a lot. As Woody Allen says, I don't want to achieve immortality through my work. I want to achieve it through not dying. And now this is going to be possible. In the Millennium Project that I direct for Latin America, we look at the trends about the future, and one of the things we are considering now is physical immortality coming soon. In fact, I wrote a book with my colleagues of the Millennium Project about the year 2030, where we are going to be reaching indefinite lifespans, and we presented this in several places, like the World Economic Forum, Davos, Switzerland, and I met with Mario Vargas Llosa, and I told him that he might be immortal if he hung on for 20 more years. And he said, well, I don't know. My new wife will help me. I was also with Donald Trump. Actually, we did 2 TV programs. Actually, this was before he became president. But anyway, very interesting to talk about immortality with Donald Trump. And in 2009, I began one of the founding faculty of Singularity University, which is mostly supported by NASA and Google. One of the things that we talk about there is immortality, because we believe that we will be reaching this very soon. The idea was popularized by Ray Kurzweil, who is almost 70 years old, and he says openly, like I do, that he does not plan to die. And I want to make it clear, I do not plan to die, and in the next 20 to 30 years, actually, when we will have rejuvenation technologies, I will be younger than today. So it's not that I'm going to be 30 years older in 30 years. I will be younger than today, so that you see what is happening. But all of this is related to the idea of the singularity. Ray Kurzweil, who again says he will not die, even though he's older, but he might, you know, survive the next 20 years, even 30 years, to reach the singularity in 2045. As you see, one of the consequences of the technological singularity is that we will become immortal. Man becomes immortal. And also for the ladies here, women also will become immortal. People don't realize how fast technology is changing, but people who have my age or more have used this technology, the IBM punch cards that we used 30 years ago to do computer work. This is 10 by 100, which is 1K. This is 1K of memory. And this was really bad 30 years ago. And then the first electromagnetic memories were invented, 8 inches big, and this was also 1K. As I like to say in Spanish, 1K plus 1K makes 1 caca. We had 1 caca of memory 30 years ago. But technology improved, and then we get into this, which is 512 cacas, and then this one, which was 1.4 mega, and then I have here a thumb drive, which is 128 gigabytes, 128 gigabytes. So we moved in 30 years from one caca to 128 gigabytes. You will remember me in the next 20 and 30 years, and you will remember caca. But this will be caca in 30 years. We will have devices more powerful than your brain in 30 years, and that will be the beginning of the technological singularity, when artificial intelligence reaches human intelligence level. And so that you do not sleep tonight, that will be the end of the human age. The end of the human age that we know of. Because once we create artificial intelligence higher than human intelligence, there will be nothing we can do before the artificial intelligence does it, unless we merge with the intelligence. And this is what we believe will happen. We will merge with the artificial intelligence, and we will become more intelligent, in fact. All these exponential technologies are happening across the board, in all technologies, in medicine, in biotechnology. And I want to show you the partial sequence of my human genome. All of you will sequence your human genome in the next 5 to 10 years, I guarantee you. And you will know which diseases you're going to have. What is the probability that you will have Alzheimer's or Parkinson's or cancer? All of you will know what you will die of, so that you do not die of that. In the future, medicine will no longer be curative. Medicine will be preventive medicine. We will prevent diseases. We will not have to cure them because we will have prevented them. After you sequence your genome, you will also know where you come from. For example, this is my paternal line, and I descend from Genghis Khan. So no one mess around with me here. Now I will show you my maternal line. And you can see from my mother's side, I come from Maria Antoinette. A very sophisticated pedigree. All of you will know where you come from, and you will be able to recreate your genealogical tree and verify for the first time if your father is really your father. But more interesting than looking into the past is looking into the future, and we will decide our children in the future. And if you do not design your children, they will sue you for not designing them properly. I did an experiment with one of my students, exchanging, sharing genes, theoretical experiment, to see which genes we could select for our children. Okay? So this will be a standard soon. And you might think this is expensive, right? This was incredibly expensive when it began. In 1990, the Human Genome Project began. And it took 13 years and over $1 billion to sequence the first human gene. Today, you can sequence your complete genome for about $850 in 2 days. And we estimate that by 2025, you will sequence your genome for $10 in 1 minute. I want you to understand those numbers. This is incredible. From $1 billion to $10, from 13 years to 1 minute. That is why all of you will sequence your genome very soon, because it will be very cheap, and you will want to know what you might die of, so that you do not die of that. So anyway, all these technologies are changing and converging. The National Science Foundation talks about NBIC, Nanobioinfocopno, and they are converging in the next 20 years in the technological singularity. The top two technologies, nano and bio, are the hardware of life. And the bottom two technologies, Info and Cogno, are the software of life. And we will reach the complexity of the human hardware and of the human software in the next 20 years. And then we will modify it, we will improve it, we will augment ourselves. Two numbers that you need to know. The complexity of the hardware, which is given by the human genome. In the year 2000, scientists for the first time created artificial viruses. In the year 2010, one professor of Singularity University created the first artificial bacteria. So when will we create something similar to humans? It is a matter of time. The human genome is 3 gigabytes of data. This pen drive is 128 gigabytes. How many humans can I fit in here? How much is 128 gigabytes divided by 3 gigabytes per person? it makes 42.6. So here you can put the genome of 42 Spanish and one little Portuguese. So this is the first number you need to know, the complexity of the human hardware, because we're basically walking information. But the other thing we need to understand is the complexity of the brain, which is the software processing mechanism of humans. A brain has 10 to the 11 neurons. Each neuron has about 1,000 connections. That makes 10 to the 14 synapses. And the synapses compute at different speeds. The brain has six main frequencies: alpha waves, beta waves, gamma waves, mu waves, etc., which are very slow. The brain is very slow. The brain computes at 1 hertz, 10 hertz, 100 hertz. A very fast brain, like my brain, is 1,000 hertz, 1 kilohertz. I have 1 kakahertz brain. My mobile phone, your mobile phone, any computer products is at least several gigahertz, several gigahertz. My phone is millions of times faster than my brain. The difference is that my brain still has more neurons than my phone has transistors. But this will change in the next 2 decades. And your phone will be more powerful than your brain. But do not worry, because you will be connected to your phone anyway. And this is a complete brain that traditionally had 3 parts. But now we are creating a 4th part, which is an exocortex, a cortex outside the brain. Sergey Brin, co-founder of Google, he says that he wants Google to be the 3rd half of your brain. Imagine that, the 3rd half of your brain. And then it would be the 4th half of your brain. And then the 5th half and the 6th half. And eventually you will have more brain outside than inside. And we will be connected through the cloud. That is why Elon Musk is working, and other people too, in different companies, to connect our brains to the internet. Elon Musk's company is called Neuralink, to connect your brain to the internet. Ray Kurzweil, he wrote this fantastic book, How to Create a Mind, that I highly recommend in Spanish, because I wrote the prologue. So you only need to read the prologue, and that's better than the book. Only 4 pages instead of 400. And so you will see how we believe that in the next 2 decades, we are going to have artificial intelligence equaling our human intelligence and merge with it. Some people are afraid of artificial intelligence, and they say, how can you be afraid of being more intelligent? Do you want to be with stupid people or with intelligent people? You shouldn't be afraid of artificial intelligence. You should be afraid of human stupidity. And human stupidity, unfortunately, is very natural. We are all stupid. So if we can become intelligent, we should be happy. Anyway, all these technologies are changing exponentially faster, smaller, cheaper, and better. But we do not understand exponential change because we think linearly. And there is a big difference between linear and exponential. If I give 30 linear steps, each one of 1 meter, after 30 steps, I have walked 30 meters. But if I walk exponentially and I double, after 30 doublings, I have walked over 1 billion meters and I have gone around planet Earth 26 times. I know this is hard for us to understand because we think linearly, we don't think exponentially, but technology is changing exponentially. So get ready for the exponential world of the future. 10 years ago, I visited Sir Arthur C. Clarke, famous for Space Odyssey 2001 and many other movies and books about the future. But he also wrote the 3 laws of the future, which are fantastic. First law of the future, when a famous scientist says that something is possible, he's probably right. But when he says it is impossible, he is probably wrong. Second law of the future, the only way of discovering the limits of the possible is to venture past those limits into the impossible. And third law of the future, any sufficiently advanced technology is indistinguishable from magic. This has a corollary. If you see a technology that does not look like magic, it's because it is not advanced. Okay, so I am going to talk about magic because we are going to see magic in the next few decades. Let's remember, 30 years ago, personal computers were just starting. Actually, when I got my first thesis at MIT, there were no personal computers. I used a typewriter. Have you seen those? Kaka Technologies? I used a typewriter at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology. 20 years ago, mobile phones were being popularized. 10 years ago, Google, Facebook, and other companies were growing internationally. So what are we going to see in the next few years? We are going to see magical things. One of those is immortal cells. In fact, we say that aging is a disease, but a curable disease. One of my friends, Aubrey de Grey, created the Methuselah Foundation to have mice that live 1,000 years, equivalent to humans. These mice normally live 2 years. So if you have a mouse that lives 20 years, that is the equivalent of 1,000 human years. And you can do the experiment in mice because they live shorter lives and they are very similar to humans. When you sequence your human genome, you will see that you share 90% with a mouse and with the rats. So if someone calls you rats, you say, and you too. We are all rats here. We are 90% equal to a rat. Okay, so they are very similar to us, or we are very similar to them, and they only live short lives, so you can do experiments. Anyway, the foundation has the Methuselah Mouse Prize for immortal mice, two parts, longevity and rejuvenation. In the last 10 years, they have been able to increase the lifespan of mice 3 times, of mosquitoes 4 times, and worms 6 times. In fact, even more interesting, today we know there are immortal cells. And Maria Blasco, she wrote a book, How to Die Young at 140 Years. This is my mother, and this is a scientist that has been able to triple the life of mice here in Madrid. There are other scientists doing similar things in other countries. Anyway, so this is happening in many countries, in Spain, in Japan, in the USA, scientists being able to change the lifespan of different animals. And we know that there are immortal cells. Actually, how many of you know that cancer cells are biologically immortal? Not many, and we're a very educated group. If you go outside, 99.9% of the people do not know that cancer is immortal, or it does not age. It is not immortal because the purpose is to kill cancer. You need to kill cancer before cancer kills you. Because cancer does not age, it grows, it reproduces, it grows, and it does not die. Cancer is the proof that immortality or not aging is possible, because cancer discovered it. So, since 1951, this patient, Henrietta Lacks, died, but her cancer cells are alive. The HeLa cells were the first cells discovered to be immortal, biologically immortal. And very few people know it. And this is a tragedy. Medicine today is a tragedy. How is it possible that we know that cancer is immortal since 1951? And almost no one knows it. Why? Because medicine has been a disaster. But we are moving now into really scientific medicine in the next few years. And people need to know that cancer cells are immortal, and also germinal cells, which are the best cells. All of you have germinal cells, and they do not age. Your germinal cells do not age. The rest of your body, which is somatic cells, it ages, but not the germinal cells. So the proof that this is possible is that it already exists. I want to make it clear. I am an engineer. When I see something that already works, what we need to do is to copy, to understand it, and to improve it. Also, there are certain animals, very simple animals, like hydras and medusas, that are biologically immortal as well. They can live indefinitely. You can find maybe a hydra which is 500 million years old. So don't kill it. We have a friend writing a book, The Death of Death, and there are actually many publications and prizes. There is a new prize which is equivalent to Nobel Prize of $1 million for the scientists that discover how to control aging. This is called the Palo Alto Longevity Prize. There are other prizes, and in fact, companies are finding that this is a great opportunity. Google created an affiliate called Calico, California Life Company, in 2013 with the objective of solving death. Death is a little technical problem. and we plan to solve it in the next 20 to 30 years. We are going to cure aging. We are going to stop death. We are going to see the death of death. But again, this is optional. If someone wants to die, no problem. You can die. That has always been the case. Now we have the possibility, though, of stopping aging. So Google is doing that. Microsoft announced that they are also going to solve cancer. Why? Because now that we sequence the human genome, you can find the mutations that stop aging in the cancer cells. And this is going to happen very soon, very, very soon. I don't know, 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, I don't know, but soon. Because it is a technical issue. We can find the mutations that cause cancer in different cells. And then Facebook, Mark Zuckerberg and his wife, Priscilla Chan, who is a medical doctor who studied biology at Harvard University, they are donating all of their fortune, all of it, to cure all diseases, all of them, including aging. So do not believe me. Believe Facebook, Microsoft, Google, IBM, that is also working with Dr. IBM. I have done a lot of TV programs internationally in the USA, in Latin America. You can find some of those if you're interested. And this was considered crazy 10 years ago. If you talked about physical immortality, they felt you are completely nuts, you are a charlatan. But now there is more evidence that we can stop aging, we can reverse aging in cells, in organisms. This is a program I had with Iñaki Gabilondo for the Spanish people. It has had more than a 250,000 views. That puts me at the same level as Shakira. But if you die, I hope that you do not die in the next 30 years so that you can live indefinitely. But if you die, we have Plan B. Plan B is cryopreservation. Actually, there are hundreds of people who are cryopreserved. These methodologies were invented in the last few decades, and it began with cryopreservation of sperm, eggs, embryos. Also, for people who tell me cryopreservation is impossible, and I say, how can it be impossible? There are thousands of humans who were cryopreserved when they were very small, okay? All those embryos, in vitro fertilization, uses embryos that were frozen or sperm or eggs. So the proof that it is possible, again, is that even humans have been cryopreserved as a small embryos. But also there are organs who have been cryopreserved and then reanimated again. So there is other proof for this. I have visited the major centers of cryopreservation in the world, like Alcor in Arizona or in Michigan, and Cryorus in Russia. And I actually was in charge of cryopreserving a friend who died in Spain last year. This was the first a Spanish person who was cryopreserved here in Spain, and he died on the 10th of February last year. Now he's having a very cool life. And we expect to reanimate his brain in the next 4 decades. Anyway, this is only Plan B, okay? Plan A is not to die. I want you to understand that very clearly. And to make a commitment to yourself like I do, that I don't plan to die because we are going to have the technology to rejuvenate soon. I organized a big event with some friends here, in fact, in May 25, 26, and 27 at the CSIC, which is the main scientific center in Spain, and with the Business School, Instituto Empresa. And then also, I am the organizer of an event in San Diego, California. I invite you to come to California to the revolution of against aging and death, where you will meet also Ray Kurzweil, who does not plan to die, also. Well, no one here plans to die, but he's probably the oldest one in this group. And Liz Parrish, who is the first human that is being rejuvenated right now. She's undergoing 2 treatments for rejuvenation. So if you want to see who we call patient zero, because she's the first patient being rejuvenated, you can go and meet her, okay? So this is not science fiction, this is science reality, this is happening today. And the more that people know that this would be possible, because again, I'm an engineer, we know that this works because nature already has immortal cells, immortal organisms. We are not talking about something impossible. It already happens. We only need to understand how to do it better and do it for us. But we need more people to understand and to know this, because many of you did not know that cancer is immortal. Okay? We are going to cure all diseases. I'm pretty sure, and you can write it down, that in 4 to 5 years we will cure paraplegics. And actually, Spain is one of the leading countries of this, because Rafael del Pino, one of the richest persons in Spain, the founder of Ferrovia, he died paraplegic. And then he donated half of his fortune to cure this disease. And in fact, they are already curing pigs, paraplegic pigs. This will soon go into human trials, and this has been done here in Spain. So we will cure paraplegics, we will cure all these horrible diseases in 10 years. There will be no Parkinson's, there will be no Alzheimer's, and there will be no aging. We are going to see the death of death. But everything has yin and yang, as the Chinese say. This is very complex, and yin yang inside has little yin yang, and even little yin yang. So we have to be aware of the dark side of the force, the dark side. So we have to meditate, we have to think about the future, we have to see what might happen in the next few years. And I finish with this beautiful Chinese word that also is used by the Japanese and the Koreans and the Vietnamese when they write in Chinese characters. This means crisis. Crisis in Chinese, Japanese, Korean, Vietnamese has two characters. The first character is danger, danger. But the second character is opportunity. We live in incredible times. We are going to see more technological changes in the next 2 decades than in the last 2,000 years. We are living in magical times. We can conquer the biggest enemy of humanity, which is aging. And as Woody Allen said, I am going to live forever or die trying. Thank you very much.
We still have time, so I don't know if you want to take it. I actually have a question for you.
Good.
Those characters that you, the characters that you placed, who draw them? You drew them?
Yes. I took Chinese calligraphy.
I do Japanese calligraphy.
Oh, okay.
Next time, I'll draw them for you.
Well, you can learn them also if you live forever, you know. You will have time to learn Chinese, to learn Russian, even to learn Klingon.
So we still have time, so I don't know if you want to take some questions.
Sure. We have 3 minutes. Any questions, comments, tomatoes, rotten eggs? Okay, please.
Okay. Hi, thanks for this speech. It was very good. I agree with you that technology should help to make people's lives better, but in the context of life, death is also implied on it, and resources, as you know, they are not infinite, and we have a problem nowadays with superpopulation in the world, and it's going to increase in the following years, so although being immortal could be scientifically possible in the future, would it be possible that everybody in the world is immortal or only the richest 1%? Thank you.
Well, being immortal, and there was a question by the lady. Okay. First of all, there are good problems to have. And not dying is a good problem to have. You know, before we didn't have the choice. But anyway, this is optional. If you are concerned about having too many people in the planet, give an example and commit suicide. But they don't want you to commit suicide, because the brain is the most complex structure in the universe that we know of today. So we need more brains. We need more people. And you're probably Spanish, right? I don't know if you know that the native population of Spain is already declining. And it does not go farther down because of all the immigration, all the people coming from Latin America, from Africa, etc. But the native population of Spain is in decline. And every 3 years in Japan, the population of Japan is going down. Actually, if nothing would change, in 2 centuries, there would be no Japanese. The population of the planet is stabilizing and then going down. It is not overpopulation. But again, it is not a problem. The brain is the most complex structure in the universe. And that is why we need more brains. You not only come with a mouth and a behind, an ass. You come with a brain, and your brain is more important than your mouse or your ass. Okay, we still have time for another quick question.
I guess my question is, okay, we might be able to solve this problem. Do we really want to solve this problem, or is it our idiosyncrasy to actually die? Like, if we say we lived 1,000 years or more than 150 years, are we going to be depressed because we're actually not ready genetically, in a way, to actually, you know, cope with the fact that we're going to stay here for 1,000 years or even 1,000,000 years?
Again, this is optional. If you get bored, commit suicide. It already happens today. People commit suicide and they don't live 1,000 years. So. I'm talking about an incredible opportunity that I think most people would like to live indefinitely because they would be younger also. It's not that you're going to be 1,000 years with 1,000-year-old body, okay? So I think most people will enjoy life, like we do now, most people enjoy life. But again, you will have the choice. So I don't see what is the problem. That is a good problem to have, like having more brains. I think having more brains is a fantastic opportunity. Anyway, so get ready for immortality, because it will be a lot of fun. Thank you.
Okay, people, so we're... Also, thank you very much.